Bill Ritchie, I'm the president of the Albany County Central Federation of Labour, and I am pumped, I can tell you, because I have just come from the Honeywell picket line, right? Which was joined, I might add, by about 50 people from IUE. And I can tell you, those damn scabs going in and out there got a bit of a scare. They really did. It was good. It was a good feeling, you know. And sheriff's people were okay. The Green Island people, of course, were like the attack dogs they've been for some time. But that's basically where I'm coming from and how I'm sort of a little bit pumped, as I said earlier on. We and the Labour Council have been very active with both campaigns, the Momentum strike, which has been going on now for, well, since November the 2nd, 700 workers on strike, and it's a strike which is really laying a template for trade unions across the nation. It is now, it's now developed to be a national issue because the Bloomberg people, you know, the Bloomberg media people were in there this week, and they almost got themselves arrested by their own mistakes, but they could hardly believe what was going on. So I think we can expect a lot more, in not just the local, but in the national press, where the Momentum strike has had amazing local media stuff from Brian Nearing, from Katie Cusick at Alt, and generally speaking, the profile of what's happening, of the disgrace that's taking place in that particular struggle, is becoming more and more apparent as the days pass. And you know, the proof of this thing is that the support which the strikers are getting from unions region wide is just rising and rising and rising. The support they're getting from the community is rising. You can't go to the headquarters except somebody's coming in there with food, they're coming in with water, they're bringing wood, and at some point they go home and they're sending money, right? So people are beginning to understand the dimensions of what the hell is going on here. We are at war. They have declared war on us, and we need to understand that. And if you think that what has happened so far, as that idiot Trump was concerned, right, you've seen nothing, I can tell you. I really believe that, right? We should start bracing ourselves for the most serious, you know, actions on our part. I mean, we have to stop playing around and talking about these people and doing press conferences and all that stuff. We have to jack up our activity to a much more serious level. Now, I'm not here to make a big long speech, okay? The other place I was tonight, was at the Honeywell strike. Now you know as well as I do, everybody in this room will believe it, right? You know those people have been out since May the 9th. No work, no pay, right? And they're hanging on, they're hanging on. And I'll tell you one thing, when the Momentum guys came, when the men and women came this evening to that picket line, it was like a shot in the arm for them, right? Yeah. Because, you know, the main gate of that plant is on a very badly, very lowly used road, right? So you don't get the same traffic as you get on the Hudson River Road for the Momentum people, or the old horns banging away every 2 seconds, right? So anyway, I think if you have an interest, which I can tell you right now, you should have. In both of those strikes, I've left flyers on the table. One of them is out of date as of about 3 minutes ago, right? Because what is advertised in the flyer is just over, right? The other one is not, and that is Saturday at Momentum at 12 noon to 2 o'clock, right? And that picket line is getting bigger. I think we probably had between 30 and 40 people on that picket line Saturday, maybe even more, right? People come and go. It's hard to say exactly how many people are sometimes there. But I can tell you tonight, there was between 50 and 60 people outside that Honeywell aerospace plant over in Green Island. And those guys are really, really up against the wall. Right. It's a very serious situation. 42 strikers, 3 shifts, night and day, right? Now, it's a very difficult situation, and I want you to be very cognizant of that. I mean, we do have to decide who we're going to align ourselves with. And as far as I'm concerned, we have to align ourselves with working people in this country. We can go to debates, we can go to all these different events, right? If you're not on that goddamn picket line, you're aligning yourself with somebody else. That's what I would say. Now, I don't want to get too... start going too much, you know what I'm saying? Because I have a lot of things to do. Okay, now, next thing, down to the format, right? I have to behave myself here. But here we go. The format is this, and it's a good one, right? We're going to ask people who have announcements to make them right now. So if you have an announcement about an upcoming event, about something that we should all be paying attention to, just put up your hand and I'll tell you. to speak. Okay, Dr. Randy, where you go?
So the local's calling for a mass picket on Sunday also, and if you want to really meet the local, you have to go on Sunday as well as Saturday.
Okay, good news. That's, you're talking about Momentum, right? Okay, good man. Any other announcements? Yeah, Sean.
I was going to mention the Momentum on Saturday, but we due to the Philly covered it. But on Sunday, the new chapter of the Albany Democratic Socialists of America is having a meeting at the Albany Public Library at 2 p.m.
Okay. Any further announcements now? Okay. Yeah, John?
Yeah, the next forum that we have scheduled, and there may be one in hopefully will be forums in February and March, but we'll be with Les Leopold, who on his new book on the runaway inequality, Friday, April 7th. But we do hope to schedule forums in in February and March, so stay tuned for that. We're talking to various speakers. And we're going to, I'm going to follow up Bill's motivation by passing around a collection basket for the Momentum.
Right.
We'll pass that around now.
Right.
Thank you, John, and thank you for being the person who is responsible, from what I can understand, for the organization of this particular forum. I want to thank you for that. I need this guy a round of applause. Woo! 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 Now, I know there are other people working on it too, and I'm not sure who they are, but if they could just believe that they were getting applauded too, okay? Okay, fair enough. One of the reasons that I am really excited about tonight is because I'm able to at least read two short paragraphs about two of my role models, right? And the first one is James Connolly, and let me just read what this Connolly Forum really is attempting to do, right? James Connolly came to the United States in 1902 and moved to Troy in 1903, setting up house at 96 Ingalls Avenue, a few blocks from where this forum takes place. He worked for the Metropolitan Insurance Company until a recession caused the firm to falter. While he was here, he was inactive in the Socialist Labour Party, where he engaged in a notable dispute with its leader, Daniel De Leon, over the utility of fighting for wages, for wage increases. He was for this, and other questions. As most of you know, when he returned to Ireland, he played a leading role in a great labour conflict, the Dublin lockout strike of 1913, and also led the Irish Citizens Army in its uprising against British rule. He was executed by the British as a result. Today he is recognised as one of the great socialist leaders of the 20th century. Amen to that. Now, the next thing that I want to talk about is my other role model, right? Ta-da! And I'm just going to say a couple of quick things here, and because you didn't come to hear me, I know that. Okay, here we go. Steve has been active, right, as a labour journalist, lawyer, organiser, union rep since 1972. For 27 years, he was a Boston-based staff member of CWA. He finished his career in CWA in 2007 after serving as administrative assistant to the VP of CWA District 1, which is our district, right,
yes.
Patty?
Yeah.
Okay. Which represents more than 160,000 workers in New York, New England, and New Jersey, right? He aided CWA organizing, bargaining, and our major strikes involving, and this will start to ring a few bells for you, right? 9X, Bell Atlantic, AT&T, Verizon, Southern New England Telephone, SBC, Singular, and Verizon Wireless. He also assisted CWA public sector organizing, plus mergers with the AFL-CIO affiliates and independent unions. Now, apart from all this, this man is a prolific writer. I mean, there's a paragraph which follows, which has about 50 different publications in it, in which he has been publishing all along. And as well as that, of course, he is the author of Embedded with Organized Labor, Journalistic Reflections on the Class War, published by the Monthly Review, 2009. And The Civil Wars in U.S. Labor, Birth of a New Workers' Movement or Death Throes of the Old, Haymarket Books, 2011. His book, Save Our Unions, Dispatches from a Movement in Distress, was published by Monthly Review Press in 2014. And his most recent book, and what you're going to hear about today, I think, mostly, is titled Big Money, Big Oil, Big Money, and the Remaking of the American Town, with a foreword by guess who? How about this? Bernie Sanders. Okay. So listen, I'm out of here, and I'll be back after Steve has finished his presentation. And I believe it'll be a question and answer period, right?
That'll be most of the session.
Yeah. Okay, okay. And I'll be up here trying to facilitate that. Okay. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Well, it is great to be back at the Connolly Forum with so many old friends and comrades and fellow union members in Troy. You know, my knowledge of James Connolly was seriously deficient until I, in the course of my CWA work, probably 25 or 30 years ago, hooked up with a guy named Jim Devine, local name. Probably the person most single-handedly responsible for that Connolly bust downtown and for inspiring institutions like the Connolly Forum and a greater and deeper sense of Irish-American and labor history throughout the region. So Jim and his brother, as you know, are legendary local characters, and Jim was a wonderful CWA local president until his local merged with Sister Patty's. And I must say, though, that everybody has gotten word about James Connolly. I was driving over here with my daughter, Alexandra Early, who's now a union organizer herself, sitting right over there,
right,
next to the books for sale. And I was on the phone with a friend in New York who we're staying with tomorrow night. And I'm not going to mention her name because it would be too embarrassing. And she says, where are you going? Well, I'm going to the Connolly Forum in Troy. Connolly Forum? I have a forum named after that guy who got killed with Kennedy in Dallas. This one is a lefty, you know. Downstaters, right? You can't live with them and you can't live without them. I mean, so I did, while driving down the Mass Pike today, a little bit of education about that Connolly and this Connolly, right? Couldn't be a bigger world of difference, to say the least. You know, I had the privilege of being in Ireland during the centennial year last fall. My wife, Alex's mother, Suzanne Gordon, has done some work over the years with the Irish Nurses Association. This was the third time they invited her over. We got to go to Kilkenny, where they had a kind of little regional congress. And we spent some time in Dublin, which is wall-to-wall Connolly. If you've been there in the last year, anybody else been over there to celebrate the anniversary? The new headquarters of the union that's a successor to the Transport and General Workers has this amazing 10, 12-story mural with 16 martyrs. And we made a trip to Bowen Mills. We've been to Kilmaine in jail. But, you know, it's a history walking tour. And how many hundreds of thousands of people, both native Irish people and the many people from around the world who are visiting Dublin now, got a real education about working class history this year. So every year should be a centennial year in Dublin. Let me thank our usual wonderful host here. I want, you know, Bill mentioned that I was involved in mergers and affiliations, and there was no prouder moment for me in the long process of working on the IUE-CWA merger than getting to know Brother Dom and the Momentum Workers, Captain Jack among them. There may be some other strikers here. We got here too late to go to the picket line. We will be there in the morning. But I want everybody to know that half the proceeds of any book sold tonight will go to the Momentum Strikers Strike Fund. The other half will go to the Honeywell workers who've been locked out by my huge speaker's fees and travel expenses. This huge pile of cash is going into that same pot. And I know everybody here has been digging deep for a long time, but one more reason to buy the book. The other reason is that the other $14 per book goes to a wonderful peace and justice, peace movement, social justice, publishing house, Beacon Press, which has been around for 160 years. Do we have any UUs in the house, Unitarian Universalist? None. I guess we're out in New England. The Beacon Press has started out as a religious publishing house. Over the years, it has published James Baldwin, Cornel West, Marion Wright Edelman, Reverend Barber's book about the Moral Monday movement in North Carolina is a recent title of theirs that's done very well. Our friend Bernie Sanders is actually only the second or third senator to provide a foreword for a Beacon Press book. There was a guy from Alaska named Mike Gravel, who back in 1971 provided a foreword to a book that was actually a multi-volume. It was called The Pentagon Papers. Not surprisingly, that became the all-time bestseller for Beacon Press. And Beacon proudly, along with the Washington Post and the New York Times, flouted the Nixon administration's attempt to block publication of the Pentagon Papers, and with Gravel providing some senatorial cover, published some very important documents that revealed a lot about the tragedy and the roots of the Vietnam War. So a great group of folks to be working with on a new book. And been doing some touring around, trying to connect with people involved in both third-party politics, the Green Party folks in many places, with the newly resurgent Democratic Socialists of America. Hundreds of new members, I hear, in many places, joining as a result of the excitement and the enthusiasm of Bernie's campaign. Been getting some help from Jacobin reading groups, from Labor Notes supporters, from old comrades in CWA, and of course, the large army of people who were part of the Labor for Bernie network. I was one of the people that helped pull that together several summers ago. It quickly grew to enormous proportions, 40 or 40,000. Oh. The words of praise you just got in absentia.
I am sorry. I just want to stop and see my mentor for 2 seconds. Hey,
learned a lot more from you than you ever learned.
Let me tell you something. I did give him a hug.
Did you give him a hug for me?
I gave him a hug, man.
I wanted to make sure I was checking on you. Hello, everybody. Sorry to type. Get back to your business. I'm sorry.
People in red, you know, they're just so physically affectionate. We just announced that half the proceeds of the sale of every book is going to go to the Momentous Strike Fund, your brothers and sisters at Lockheed. We're doing some collecting for you, so you will fly here tonight with some money and some out-of-town visitors to the picket line tomorrow morning. So.
Oh, fantastic. Thank you so much, guys.
What this book really is about is based on the last 5 years that I've spent in California. I moved from Boston in 2012. I had, as Bill said, worked for CWA for nearly 30 years. And in California, I was lucky enough to land in a wonderful, vibrant, feisty blue-collar city in the East Bay across from San Francisco called Richmond. And we have some people here. John and Nancy have been to Richmond. Alex was there for 6 months in 2012, actually was a canvassing coordinator for the Richmond Progressive Alliance, which is a political formation described in the book. Anybody else, Bay Area visitors, ever been to? Andy has been to Richmond? You have been to Richmond?
Yeah. I used to live in California.
Oh, really? Okay. A lot of people, because Richmond historically had a kind of bad rep, avoided the place. A snobby mayor in a suburb nearby called El Cerrito once had the chutzpah to describe Richmond as the armpit of the East Bay. Now, people from Troy, of all people, will appreciate that kind of slur. Yes. Because I remember how the old Troy used to be, the last century Troy, sometimes referred to by snobby neighbors. And, you know, Richmond, for those who have been there, John was there 2 years ago for a wonderful conference. Of cross-craft, cross-industry conference of railroad union activists and members of the United Steelworkers, who at that time were just winding down their first nationwide selective strike and contract campaign in 30 years, targeting Chevron, our new industrial neighbor in Richmond, and other big oil refiners, and conducting a really exciting campaign that embodied the vision of a blue-green alliance. The steel workers didn't just strike for better pay and benefits, which of course they deserve, working long 12-hour shifts in places like this, but their demands for curbs on forced overtime, curbs on contracting out of their work, and a whole host of demands related to workplace safety were not only for the benefit, thank you, Sister Alex, not only for the benefit of their own members who work in a very hazardous, high-risk workplace, oil refineries, but for the surrounding community. And not all unions on the property of Chevron and other refineries in California and other states are so forward-looking. You know, we have our brothers and sisters in the building trades who have the piece of the action in the oil industry and tend to be much more narrower in their outlook, tend to support the company politically, support its agenda in legislation and politics and the regulatory arena. And the United Steelworkers, as I describe in this book, have for 100 years, originally as the Oil Workers International Union, and then for many years as the Oil, Chemical, and Atomic Workers, have had a long, courageous struggle for autonomy and independence from a company very skilled. Originally it was Standard Oil, recent decade Chevron, at dividing and conquering and pitting one part of its workforce against another, pitting labor against the community, dominating the politics of oil towns like Richmond. And that's a strike and contract campaign 2 years ago was a renewed declaration of independence and a reflection of the understanding by at least some refinery workers and some local union leaders in the U.S., the United Steelworkers, that they need to get back to their OCAW roots, embrace, you know, the message and the visionary preachings of our old friend Tony Mizaki, who was one of the first to point out that, you know, a fossil fuel-based economy is not sustainable. We need renewable energy sources, and we need a just transition for those workers, whether they're coal miners, whether they're pipeline workers or Chevron workers, who in many cases would prefer to be doing something else that's not destroying the planet. But until we come up with something else for them to do that's viable and it's real, and Tony's idea was to create, as many of you know, a super fund for workers to help them transition to other kinds of more green jobs. So part of the book is kind of telling that labor history of struggle to get this refinery organized. What I was surprised to find in talking to old-timers was that the Chevron Richmond Refinery has been an open shop for 65 years. The company succeeded in staying non-union until 1950, long after other CIO unions made major gains in steel and auto and rubber manufacturing and coal mines. Standard Oil and Chevron have never been willing to agree to a union security language. They have used contracting out, a common employer tool now in manufacturing and many sectors, to undermine industrial unionism. The Steelworker Bargaining Unit in Richmond once had 2,000 workers, down to about 700. And, you know, the open shop really puts the leadership to a test because we have people in that refinery who bravely, during their contract campaign and the strike elsewhere 2 years ago, linked arms with 350.org and Greenpeace and Communities for a Better Environment and the Sierra Club. And whenever people take that step to kind of unite with community organizations, the management of Chevron goes around on the shop floor and reminds people that there may be a maintenance and membership clause, but there's a dropout period. And your union leadership is not representing your best interests. It's out there consorting with local radicals and environmental extremists that want to shut this place down. So you should get out of the union. So that's a very, very different dynamic than exists in CWA or PEF or the nurses unions or SEIU when, you know, people pass exemplary resolutions about climate change and environmental issues, but aren't taking any risk, really, when they do that, because their membership is not at risk of losing jobs if we had a real major shift, which we need sooner rather than later, from this kind of employment to good jobs in renewable energy. The other thing that's interesting, I think, about the story is that after a century of oil company domination of the politics of Richmond, which is a largely non-white city, 80% black, Latino, Asian, 110,000 people, blue-collar, poor, working class, about 15 years ago, a coalition came together to challenge the entrenched interests that had protected Chevron from any real regulation of its maintenance and refinery safety practices, and would not push for emissions controls and other measures that were long overdue to force the company to operate this refinery in safer fashion. This coalition, in interesting fashion, was a kind of a united front. It drew together Green Party members, dissident Democrats, Latinos and African Americans, you know, disgruntled with the mainstream of the Democratic Party, as many Bernie supporters are today. It included some people who belonged to another third party, the Peace and Freedom Party. It included independents, people in about three different socialist groups, trade union activists, and unusual on the left or in the progressive movement, they pledged to kind of work together around an agenda for transforming the city, for taking over City Hall and making Richmond city government a laboratory for innovative, progressive, pro-labor, pro-environmental public policies. That required setting aside some big picture differences about the nature of the capitalist system and, you know, what brand of socialism is best and whether people in the Green Party should work with non-Green Party members or just run under their own banner. But this ecumenical, more flexible and pragmatic approach has paid off. Today, the Richmond Progressive Alliance has about 300 to 400 dues-paying members. It's a membership-based organization. It also has organizational affiliates, both community groups and leading unions, the California nurses, the transit workers, the Longshore Union, an SEIU local and an AFSCME local, and the National Union of Healthcare Workers, Alex's union. They all have representation on the steering committee. And over 15 years, they've been able to build this group, when we've been involved for five of those 15 years, a really vibrant and successful, multiracial, working class oriented, progressive movement that doesn't just do electoral politics every 2 years, has a program of community organizing year-round that strengthens its ability to compete in municipal elections, not just as a protest candidate, a marginal third-party candidate, a propaganda campaign, an educational campaign, but people who have the capacity to run and win. And since 2004, the RPA has won 10 out of 16 city council and mayoral races in which it has participated. The first breakthrough was when a great Green Party leader in California, Gayle McLaughlin, ran for the city council in 2004 under the RPA banner. 2 years later, in a three-way race against two establishment business-backed Democrats, she made Richmond the largest city in the country with a green mayor. And believe me, that was a woman bites dog story, right? You know, green mayors, they get elected in places like New Paltz, right? Progressives get elected mayor in Burlington, Vermont, or Madison, or Santa Cruz, or Santa Monica, you know, going back to the 70s or 80s. A little more unusual for somebody on the left who's pro-labor, a green, to get elected in a place that's been dominated for 100 years by one of the biggest energy companies in the world. And to win, the RPA, starting with Gayle, had to overcome a coalition of Chevron, major developers, other business interests, the police and firefighter unions, and our friends in the building trades, who have not been on the right side of local electoral politics in Richmond in recent years, in my view. Though there have been some issues where common ground was found, and we could talk about that, because you need to find common ground. We can't have Trump running off with major chunks of what's left of the labor movement, and he made a good start at doing that, I would say, this week. So let's come back to that, because there's a lot, I think, to be learned from the Richmond experience, you know, trying to find a way to work with trades. One margin of referendum. After a 15-year struggle, Richmond became the first city in Northern California in 30 years to enact rent control. Rents were immediately rolled back to the level of the year before, and we now have a legal requirement that there be no landlord evictions of tenants without just cause. Tremendous breakthrough, and we have a rent board that's now going to be adjudicating complaints and disputes. Prior to that, tenants, mainly people of color, low-income, working class in Richmond, were very much threatened by Bay Area gentrification trends. You know, people pushed out of San Francisco, and they moved to Oakland, they get pushed out of Oakland, they come to Richmond, and the landlords say, well, why do we need you? You know, we got somebody here to pay $500 more a month for the same space. Well, until November 8th, they could kick somebody out. No questions asked, no legal recourse to make as much money as they wanted off of any kind of a rental property. So that was an important achievement. When you link progressive candidacies to popular ballot measures, and not all ballot measures supported by the RPA have been popular, there's a chapter about the debacle in 2012 when people ran promoting a soda tax, which seriously backfired on the movement, and we can talk more about that. But rent control last fall enabled two RPA candidates to get elected. Here's their pictures, both young folks, one of them a Korean-American environmentalist, Ben Choi, who'd been on the Richmond Planning Commission and very active in holding Chevron accountable in whatever way that body could. And his running mate was 26-year-old Melvin Willis, a Richmond native, Bernie-inspired candidate, who's worked for the last 4 years as a community organizer for the Alliance of Californians for Community Empowerment, the successor to ACORN. And first-time candidates in Richmond, like in most places, don't tend to win, you know, even when they're backed by the RPA. The incumbents, they may suck, but they've got name recognition and they've got money behind them. So most people, except for Gayle, have had to run one or two times to break through. These guys won on their first outing. Melvin topped a field of nine and beat by 2,000 votes the senior member of the city council, a Chevron-backed conservative African-American Democrat by the name of Nat Bates. He beat him by 2,000 votes, and Bates is now off the council. We have a 5 out of 7 progressive supermajority on the Richmond City Council, and I think Melvin is on track to be running for mayor in 2 years and join another great Bernie-backed candidate in the Bay Area, who just got elected mayor of Stockton. At the same time, these guys were running, with help from Our Revolution, Bernie's post-campaign organization. A Latino young man was elected mayor of Berkeley, came very close to electing a great Bernie supporter, Jane Kim, to the state senate in San Francisco. She was running against a corporate Dem that, you know, got several million dollars in independent expenditures on his behalf from various corporate interests. So this is a remarkable story and a reflection of what can happen when you try to rethink electoral politics and don't just pop up at election time and just don't make it an individual, entrepreneurial, good government liberal activity. Rooted in movements, you know, get people to commit to run with small Bernie-style donations, private donations. One of the reforms of the last 15 years is public matching funds in Richmond, you know, a very, very important tool for maximizing the impact of your small donations. They have a system like that in New York City. I think it's responsible really for probably 20 of the progressives, the progressive caucus members getting elected, much more generous match than we have. But at its peak, the Richmond match enabled anybody who could raise $30,000 to get $25,000 in city funds. You know, when you're up against what has been spent by corporate interests in the last three election cycles, more than $7 million spent by Big Oil, Big Soda, and last fall, the landlord lobby. These sums are pretty small, but what levels the playing field ultimately is the kind of grassroots organization and canvassing operation of the sort that Alex was involved in building in 2014. The fact that people are organizing year in and year out, that you have constituent organizations that have members who are both Richmond residents and union activists at the BART, University of California, in the Port, at Kaiser Richmond Medical Center. I think there's tremendous potential in the wake of Bernie's inspiring campaign for two, three, many Richmond Progressive Alliances, or whatever you call them, popping up. When Bernie put out the word in June, the call for his supporters to sign up on his website to run for city council, run for school board, run for mayor, run for the state legislature, run for all kinds of local elected bodies, 25,000 people responded. And some of them are already part of groups, some are trying to form groups, will go off and perhaps do it in a traditional way, pretty much by themselves, trying to build an individual following. But the Richmond model enables you to hold the people you elect accountable, because you put people in office, we see this all the time, the labor movement is perpetually disappointed by labor-friendly candidates. They come under enormous pressure, from their peer group, which majority of which may not be progressive, from the business interests that want to block progress at city, state, county, federal level. But in this next 4 years, as inspiring and encouraging as the upsurge was over this last weekend, we're not going to get too far moving forward inside the Beltway. It's going to be a series of defensive battles. There's still political gridlock at state level. But at the local level, there's a lot of openings, and particularly in human scale cities of 50 to 100 to 200,000, where over a period of time, through systematic canvassing, building up a base of ID voters, building membership organizations rather than just campaign organizations at election time, you can really put down roots, and you can win people over, you can get stronger, and you can beat people who otherwise look pretty unbeatable, and who definitely have the deeper pockets. So why don't I stop there, and I know we got people with extensive union and political activists and perhaps electoral politics experience here, and the Working Families Party, the Democratic Party, the Green Party, other groups, and compare notes and ask some questions and share information. I'm going to call on Alex now and then, because in the months that she was doing door-to-door canvassing in Richmond, she probably did more hard, real work than I've done in 5 years there, because the bottom line is easy to talk and write about this stuff, much harder to actually go out and do it, whether it's union work or political work or community organizing. So this is the real resource person. And I would say also, though she's not been a Richmond resident for the last 2 years, one of the internal things that I tried to describe in the RPA that's a real plus is that the organization was started by kind of older people who are not particularly reflective of the community. And over the last 2 years, the group has made a conscious effort to have a generational transfer of power within the group and develop new leaders, like Ben, Melvin. The older people and unions need to take note of this process. Older people, stale, male, male, female, been around a while, take a step back, create some space for the under 30s, for the under 40s, right? Dom is somebody who has taken this message to heart long ago, but not enough people do. And so now we have a steering committee that's elected by the members, majority of people of color, majority female, and people in their 30s and 40s instead of people in their 50s and 60s and even 70s.
Right.
We're not excluding people in their new old age, but much better that they hang on as mentors and supporters and secondary volunteers rather than the face of the organization. So I think that's another positive feature of the RPA model, and hopefully that'll be sustained and some others will take heed of that important lesson. So why don't we open it up? Shall we do the labor notes thing? Alternate between men and women to make sure we have gender balance?
I think that's a good idea.
Okay.
And also, if somebody asks a question, then they would need to wait until everyone else who asks the question has had their chance. Okay?
Yeah, that's good. And one question to a customer. We know there's a multi-point question / statement / speeches. You get to make it tonight, but only in serial fashion after everybody else has had a chance to speak. Okay. All right, we're agreed on the ground rules. Brother from the Green Party.
My question is, what do you think the major... How did you win? I mean, we've run candidates here in Albany, Troy, candidates that were good at every level. And we've tried to figure out how to have a consistent type of victory, any victory at all, really. What do you think the major factors were? Was it, the social organization work? Was it you really knew how to go door-to-door, great literature? I mean, just, I'm curious, because you had success.
Well, definitely the canvassing approach is a little different. Do you want to talk about that, Alex? I mean, what was different in 2014 as compared to other canvassing you've done more recently for issues in Massachusetts?
I think that it was important that they that the RPA really does work with, as you mentioned, a coalition of other organizations, and they worked out when they reached out to these other organizations when they started doing canvassing, and they did more of that deep canvassing very early on in the I think it was good 6 months before the election started. We started looking for canvassing volunteers from all of these other coalition organizations and in every area of Richmond, and so people were able to have long conversations at every door they knocked on as they were canvassing, look for other volunteers as they were canvassing. That was my main experience, was just with the canvassing effort, which started really early. And I've done canvassing for different ballot measures and state-level measures in Massachusetts outside of Boston, and we always did it like 2 months before and the week before, and when people don't want to talk to you anymore, don't answer the door. So that makes a difference.
So in that year, when Chevron started really pouring the big bucks into the negative ads, and hundreds of thousands of dollars that they spent supporting their mayoral candidate and a quasi-slate of three business-friendly council candidates, which, close to the traditional time frame of Labor Day. So the billboards go up then, and your mailbox, in Richmond, you have to get a bigger mailbox at election time when you got a company like Chevron in an electorate of 30 to 40,000. Overkill, really. Glossy brochures after glossy brochures, billboards, social media, radio, TV, saturation bombing. And then they send out paid canvassers to knock on the door. And the difference between a volunteer who lives in the community and a paid canvasser, pretty quick to pick up. But, because Alex and her colleagues, got out there early, they reached people before people were just shutting down under the barrage. And the later canvassing was much harder and less effective. But when you're able, and through many election cycles, to know more about who you're visiting and how they voted in the past and have they volunteered and have they participated in past campaigns and, what are their issues? Is it rent control? Was it the anti-foreclosure fight? Is it the schools, which the city really doesn't have much control over. People are canvassing not blind. Sometimes they're meeting new people who've just moved in, but there's a pretty big database, just like any union would have in a major organizing campaign, on who they're house visiting. And, when Big Soda sends out two managers, came knocking on my door, two Coke bosses, why I should be against the soda tax. Are you guys doing this on your own time? And then Chevron hires paid canvassers. I mean, the volunteer element over time is a critical factor. The RPA has never taken foundation grants. It's relied on voluntary contributions, volunteers in campaigns, to staff the office, to staff the all of its work. And that's a tough model to sustain. But it also frees you up from dependence on other people setting your priorities and controlling your organization and pushing it in a direction that may be unhelpful. And I would say that includes some of your union partners who may sometimes be pushing and pulling in a way that's not always helpful. So, looking for a female hand. Yes, the sister here.
Volunteered on behalf of my gender or something like that. I guess I was wondering how being it was like minority white city, how you feel. I mean, I know it's all supposition, but how, I mean, working in Massachusetts, whether, like, was the liberal Democrat base really mostly white, and like, did people shift? Like, how did that play into this?
You mean in Massachusetts politics?
No, or? I mean, I was just saying, I mean, I think it looked, maybe Alexander might have some experience in.
Well, she was working in Chelsea, Mass, actually, a community kind of like Richmond, but without a refinery. But, you know.
I think she's asking about California.
About California?
Yeah.
How you would apply this in a place with a more, a less majority-minority demographic. Well, you know, we've gotten contacted recently by a very interesting mix of people. There's a group up in Humboldt County, way up in the north of California, one of the great marijuana growing centers of the state, Eureka, to be exact. And they have a Humboldt County People's Alliance, and they've been doing electoral politics, plugged into the Bernie campaign. There's a group being formed in Vallejo that's more Richmond style. We've got invitations to come down, speak to folks in San Jose. Santa Rosa in Sonoma County has a rent control measure on the ballot in June, and I think they are going to have a greater challenge because there's more of a white suburban commuter population there, but also a growing Latino minority tenants who definitely have a stake in the rent control fight. But I think there, if the California Apartment Association spends as much as it did in Richmond and several other Bay Area communities where it was on the ballot last fall, they may be able to pit homeowners against, you know, tenants there. So you're absolutely right. I mean, it's not a perfectly reproducible model everywhere, but, you know, company towns come in many different forms. I mean, you live in Berkeley, you see Berkeley is the big dog, and you go to Seattle, where Kashama Sawant, Socialist Alternative, has made amazing inroads. You know, Boeing and Amazon and Microsoft, that troika has turned Seattle pretty much into a company town, though it's contested their domination. So company towns come in a lot of form, and I don't think you need, you know, Richmond's particularly heavy minority population to organize around some of these issues. And certainly the RPA lost some people last fall in the 20% of the population that's a little more affluent, it's white, you know, you've been to Point Richmond. Some of those folks were not keen on rent control. Some of them have a second house that they rent out. You know, am I never going to be able to evict a bad tenant? It's not really directed at you, but those people who were RPA supporters around Chevron issues, refinery safety, environmental stuff, you know, other good government questions, bailed on rent control. But, you know, black and Asian and Latino foreign working people or tenants turned out in droves to pass this thing. So where you lose votes, you try to find other places to pick them up. So the brother in back has his hand, and then we'll get John.
Up here with the Bernie campaign, we won the 19th, 20th, and 21st district.
Yep.
And we did it with canvassing. That was a very important tool. We canvassed all the city of Albany, city of Troy, Saratoga, and Glens Falls, and we won those cities. But we also did a very important thing. We did a big voter registration drive.
Yep.
And we registered over 2,000, mostly students, in the capital district. We got the students out. We won the younger vote for Bernie, and that was crucial in upstate New York to our win. And, you know, it's really telling that most people in this country are not registered. Yep. Most people have been depoliticized, and we have to repoliticize them in terms of voting because they're not voting. They really didn't realize a lot of things about the Democratic primary that Bernie jumped into here, and they didn't realize the dates that you had to become in the party. But we did register Republicans into the Democratic Party up here. So, you know, we've got voter registration is really essential, and the rallies that we did were really essential too.
Yep.
We did a series of rallies and marches through Albany and through almost every city in the Capital District, and that really got us some good headlines. So, you know, I think a good campaign is a multifaceted kind of a thing. You've got to have a good core campaign committee, which we had. You had to have the operation going daily, and you had to have the volunteers. And the volunteers is what did it. We had a whole lot of volunteers, and we still exist in the Capital District with the Progressive Alliance Network, which is a burning organization.
Yep.
It's reformed and it's a growing organization.
Well, we owe a great debt to Bernie. He was invited by Gayle McLaughlin, who was then mayor, 2 years ago to come and speak at a town hall meeting in October of 2014, right before the big showdown with Chevron that year. We got 500 people, which you know, later on that was bumpkins, but at the time that was a lot of people who listened to Bernie making an out-of-state you know, trial balloon tour stop. He did a fundraiser for the RPA. We did a collection at the mass meeting, raised close to $10,000 for a lot in one day. And then he also, you know, participated in the CNA, California Nurses Association rally, went over and met with the ILWU in San Francisco, had a meeting with the hotel workers leadership, San Francisco, Sal Roselli from NUHW. So that trip helped cement relationships with several of the unions that became among the top four or five or six that supported him last year, along with CWA. And then Bernie, or his post-campaign organization, Our Revolution, endorsed our two council candidates and sent out one email blast that within 48 hours raised $5,000 for each of these two guys who won. And, you know, we got a list of 900 to 1,000 new small donors, some in town and some out of town, who were part of Bernie's enormous donor base of 2.5 million. And post-June, Democratic June primary of last year, there was an influx of younger people got involved in our council campaign who had never paid much attention to city politics before. I mean, they were inspired by the Bernie thing. They had other things going on. And they were looking around for what do you do next, right? Mm-hmm. And we were there. We had a campaign. We had the rent control thing. So it was very exciting kind of synergy of the national campaign and then feeding into the local campaign. And the challenge is going to be, you know, trying to keep them involved, change the culture of the organization so they feel welcome and developed and get training and support. But I think that, you know, the potential for that, as you just described, has been realized already in a number of places and is great in many others. So I'm hoping that, you know, Our Revolution got off to a rocky start, but I think 60 of its 100 endorsed candidates around the country won last fall. And, you know, some of them were not Democrats. You know, Gayle is not a Democrat, but she got OR's endorsement. The new lieutenant governor of Vermont, Dave Zuckerman, is progressive. First time the Progressive Party has ever elected somebody statewide with his kind of politics. He ran as a PD, took out an establishment Dem in the Democratic primary. What's that?
Any in New York State?
In Vermont.
Not here, though. I don't think any in New York.
It's the Vermont Progressive Party.
Anybody in New York? I'll put it in. Okay.
Yeah. But,
but you know, any Our Revolution candidates would in New York State.
Do you know? Were there any local wins?
No.
All our endorsed candidates?
Not here. Nicole lost.
It was a little chaotic. You know, there wasn't a very very systematic process of how people applied and got, you know, that. But certainly the people who did get help, Alex's sister was managing the campaign of a great nurse running for the state legislature in Vermont, Mari Cordes, been a leader of the AFT nurses up in Burlington. She got one of these email blasts on the front end of her campaign and raised $15,000 to $20,000. She didn't know what to do with the money. She gave it to the Progressive Party, what was left over. So that list is powerful if it's not overused. And if the focus remains on building grassroots capacity, which can't be done from a little boiler room on Capitol Hill with young people very skilled at social media and sending emails, you know, not against that. We got some money out of that. But real organizing is face-to-face, knocking on doors, what you just described, what Alex described, what everybody here has been doing for years. If you don't do that, you know, it's moveon.org, you know, point one or two or something.
Right, right.
All right, female hand, and then right here. It's
just so do you think the grassroots activity that you've described has contributed to California, like the governor and the leadership being apparently like firmer in terms of opposing Trump than almost any other state?
Well, California's definitely getting headlines. you know, some of it's posturing by liberal Democrats who in local context don't look too good. In the national context at the moment, they're striking heroic stances, and we'll see what the follow-up is. I mean, certainly the concept of spreading the concept of sanctuary cities is catching on.
Yeah.
I mean, Rahm Emanuel is a sanctuary city mayor. You know, so that's a broad tent at this point, and we need it. But I wouldn't kick him out over other issues. We'd lynch him. But, I mean, so Richmond was a pioneering sanctuary city as part of its community policing reform efforts. Our police chief is profiled in the book, made it clear to the feds, along with the city, support of the Gayle and the city council, we're not going to cooperate with any kind of immigration roundup in our city. It destroys, you know, the then tentative efforts to rebuild trust and confidence and a better relationship between the police and the community that it serves in Richmond. The current mayor, you know, is much more moderate and Democrat, has reiterated that stance. So I think the sanctuary city movement in California, of all parts of the country, is real strong because so many of the people have a stake in it. And it makes electoral sense for liberal Democrats to stick up for Latino immigrants in particular in California who are at risk of being rounded up, you know, per Trump administration schemes that are unfolding by the day. So in terms of the environmental stuff, you know, the Chevron wields enormous influence in California politics. I mean, they are a polluter not just of Richmond's politics, but of state politics. And they have blocked some very important measures in recent years that would have made a dent in slowing down global warming. You know, they fight any attempt to, reduce, car and truck use of fossil fuels. They spent heavily in Monterey County opposing a referendum that would have blocked fracking, and that was passed. So they don't always win, but it helps to be well organized to beat them. And at the state level, they just lay so much money. You know, California, 2/3 of the state assembly and the Senate is Democrats. You know, talk about a supermajority, but they don't do much with it. And that's because Chevron is very skilled at spreading money around and neutralizing support that much-needed measures otherwise should have. So we'll see. Maybe the challenge of Trump will make some of these people better. And okay, so we got a lot of hands up here, Sean, and then I've got four other people in queue.
Yeah, before you've talked about like the Vermont Progressive Party and you've talked about the Working Families Party and the flaws and the pros and cons of both approaches, and you know, I was talking about like this model that you're talking about in the book as being a good a potential model for other cities Troy's side, cities Albany side,
yeah.
Schenectady. Recently Troy, the UWFP ran, essentially an abortive attempt at, a slate here in Troy, which, ultimately led to a GOP majority of the most reactionary stripe that, at least in the area. And so I'm wondering, comparing and contrasting, what you've seen in RP, with RPA in Richmond versus WFP, and looking at that in the sort of in the Troy context of being a very typical sort of Northeast New England ed-med town. It's relying on RPI, it's relying on the hospitals.
Yeah.
What are some ideas that you have?
Well, I think you do have to look at the context. You have to look at what are the local election rules. I mean, one of the reasons why third parties have been totally, I think, wiped out, marginalized in California, you know, above the level of the municipalities where you can intervene under these kinds of circumstances and run and win in these so-called nonpartisan elections. Now, you know, the legislative elections in California have this jungle primary system. Basically, every Republicans, the independents, the Greens, the Peace and Freedom fossils, and then the top two duke it out in the general election. So there's no third or fourth party choice in the general election anymore in California. So it's usually a Democrat and a more conservative Democrat who then tries to get the Republican support that, you know, went to the Republican candidates who were eliminated in the first round. So in that situation, you don't even have the opportunity to be a spoiler in the general election because you don't get that far. In other situations, you do have to be, I think, kind of careful and selective. I, you know, some people, my friend Howie Hawkins is very critical of anything that smacks of fusion, anything, you know, inside, outside, involving the Democrats. The Vermont Progressive Party for a long time, you know, had difficulty breaking through at the in statewide races, running as a pure third-party candidate. And I think it was a smart move for Zuckerman to not just get the Progressive Party nomination, as he certainly would have gotten for Lieutenant Governor as Progressive State Senator, leader of the statewide party, but by taking a Bernie-style detour into the Democratic primary last summer, he knocked out a corporate Dem who was a legislative leader, and then would go into the did go into the fall election one-on-one with the Republican as a PD. Democratic Party was not happy with this. They wouldn't share a list with him. They, you know, for years they've been saying to the Vermont Progressive Party, why don't you come and join us? You don't need your little splitter, spoiler group over here. So people have started to do that in a fashion. They haven't joined. They've picked up the endorsement in the primary and then gone back to the general election running as a PD. You know, the results in Vermont were very revealing and very much tracked Bernie's success over the years in statewide races, running maybe 30,000 votes ahead of the top Democrat, like Peter Shumlin, and he's on the ballot at the same time. And those other 30,000 votes come from people who don't vote for the Democrat who's running for governor, right? Because they're independents, working class Republicans, people that don't like the Democrats but like what Bernie stands for. And Zuckerman, you know, kind of a protege of Bernie, you know, different, ponytail, organic farmer, UVM graduate, you know, pro-labor, but not as strong on workers' rights, I would say, as Bernie, but getting there. You know, he beat Randy Brock by 7,000 votes. How did the gubernatorial race turn out in the same electorate?
Not so good.
A Hillary Clinton clone lost to a nice guy Republican. Mm-hmm. So how does that math work? So the progressive got votes from people who voted for the Republican for governor and didn't like, you know, Sue Minter, who was, you know, a Hillary knockoff. I think the Progressive Party, by being savvy, by being pragmatic, by being flexible, but maintaining, you know, a distinct third-party identity, is a good model to avoid the box of being a spoiler and getting creamed, as poor Ralph did in 2000 for supposedly contributing to a worse electoral outcome in the form of some terrible Republicans. But, you know, some of that is hard to assess accurately before you throw your hat in the ring organizationally, and there are definitely going to be times when, you know, a vote is going to be split if you have a strong third-party candidacy, you know, as the VPP had done several times, even coming in second in one gubernatorial race with Anthony Polina, doing better than the Democrat. The Democrat was the spoiler then, but, you know, getting to a winning level of voter turnout, they came close 2 years ago with 36% of the vote, and then David one-on-one, you know, maybe on his way to, you know, being the first progressive governor of the state. We'll see.
Thank you.
Sister here.
Okay, and then my neighbor here has also had his hand up, so if
okay.
I ask my question.
Okay.
This is a little bit different. I went to the demonstration in New York City yesterday, and of course it was enormous, and it was also extremely diverse.
Mm-hmm.
It's an immigrant city, and My question is, so you know, it's debatable how many actually, 300, 400,000, who knows? The point is that these are great things, but how do you take it to another level? Mm-hmm. And particularly with all these young people, how do you bring them into the kind of movement that we're talking about, where they can become empowered and they can lead in their own areas? And that was the thing that I came away with it. Like, this is fantastic. Now what?
Well, I think that is one of the challenges of last weekend. I mean, the turnout in little out-of-the-way places was astounding to people who lived there for a long time. I was in Greenfield on just the other night, and they had 2,500 people. Fortunately, they have a group called Franklin County for Continuing Our Political Revolution. How's that for an acronym? It's the local Bernie-crats, union activists, community organizers, people pushing for municipal broadband in the rural towns around in that corner of Massachusetts. They are actively doing follow-up campaign, Bernie campaign work. They built a membership base of 130 dues payers. You know, they've got to figure out, all right, are we going to do something at the county level, which in Massachusetts is not much to run for there? Which towns do we focus on? What boards do we try to get on? How do we get more young people involved? And how do we translate the great display of direct action and spontaneous mass activity in response to Trump into something that takes organizational form, probably first at the local level? I mean, this level of mass demonstrating, you know, is going to be hard to sustain. When you look back at 2005, I believe it was, when we had the first serious major immigrant rights protests and demonstrations, you know, it was a buildup over 3 months to May 1st that year, and the crowds got bigger in March and then April and kind of peaked on May 1st. I mean, Saturday was raised the bar. In Montpelier, you know, city population of 7,000, 20,000 people out in front of the state house, biggest crowd in the history of the state, three times what Bernie got when he announced his candidacy in Burlington in June of 2015, and it's like 3% of the population, and I think there's stories like that all over. But you know, in some places, people will be more adrift until they get the call for the next demonstration, and you know, go to the next demonstration. But if there's not something they can plug into that, you know, appears to be making a dent in what we're all up against on so many fronts. But I think, you know, none of the organizers in any of these places, certainly not the group organizing this Montpelier thing, they were thinking, yeah, we have a May Day rally every year, a couple thousand people, you know, maybe a little bit bigger, but lots of people going to D.C., so we're not sure. And then, you know, the state cops are shutting down Interstate 89 before rally start time, so... it's, you know, it also reminds us who get cynical and depressed and jaded and doom and gloom filled for understandable reasons that, you know, when these spontaneous uprisings occur cannot be easily predicted. And we shouldn't always be so sure that we know who's going to show up for what and when and where. And
we had one in Albany last Saturday.
What's that? And
we had one in Albany last Saturday.
Yeah, okay. Yeah. So
we had a record 7,000 to 10,000 people.
I think there were records broken everywhere. So, as the sister said, the challenge is, where do we take it next? The brother here, and then back here, and then.
Art's been waiting.
All right, go ahead.
What's that?
Art's been waiting long.
All right. Yeah, okay. All right. Well, the brother here in the green. Well, we're going to get to everybody. So Art, okay. The sister behind,
okay?
The brother in the green sweater.
Are you okay to keep going?
What's that?
Are you okay to keep going?
No, I'm. Everybody.
Okay, great.
I just don't think I'm trying to call on everybody. I can't do it at once. He's been waiting, and now she's waiting. So, Art, you're on.
I just wondered if I recall correctly.
You're going to have to wait longer. I tried.
When Tony Mazzocchi started the Labor Party, I didn't think at the beginning he was interested in electoral politics right at the beginning, maybe in the long run. So what was your thinking with the RPA?
Well, Tony, I was a Labor Party supporter, and... trying to get Cedar Murray folks interested. We had a great District 1 vice president back then, Patty knows that Jan Pierce was a big fan of Tony and promoted Labor Party advocates and the Labor Party. You know, it did kind of stall out at a certain point when there was a decision not to run candidates, and that was kind of controversial, and some people, you know, circumstances changed, some of the official union support started to drift away. The Nader campaign really, I think, tarred the effort, even though they weren't connected, though there was some overlap. And I think the RPA experience is when, at the formation, you know, the scene was like it is in most places. You had a bunch of activists pursuing single issues, you know. In 2002 and 2004 in Richmond, you know, there was a homelessness group. There was a group, West County Toxic Coalition, and some other groups ragging on Chevron. There was already, you know, a tenants group. We need rent control. There were people who had been beaten up by the police and had to sue the city for damages. We need a new police department. This one has to go. That got on the list, high up on the list. The police at that time were doing random, you know, roadblocks and stops and harassing undocumented people in the city. You know, so you had a whole bunch of people, the usual smorgasbord of single issues, and they had to agree, you know, to kind of hitch their wagons together in a way that would maximize the impact of their separate and hopefully more complementary efforts. And so those single issues became part of the electoral program of the group. People agreed to commit a certain amount of time to joint work and to supporting a joint slate. The unions, and I think this is healthy, you know, because you've all been in unions where in, I'm sure, local elections, state elections, unions ended up backing candidates in a competitive fashion, you know, driven by their own priorities and agendas and personal connections to particular polls. Within the framework of the RPA, with, at least with the CNA, the SEIU local that represents city employees, the transit workers, NUHW, we have not had a situation where, at least at the local level, they're backing anybody other than the agreed United Front candidates. And that makes a big difference, because then their donations, their, when they max out in individual donations or any independent expenditures, which aren't big, but AFSCME and SEIU have made a few, and the CNA, you know, they don't cancel each other out, which we see evidence of when the Workers' Family Party unions run somebody, and then another bunch of unions don't like that person, and they run somebody. And I mean, talk about splitting and dividing and weakening your own forces. So that kind of corralling of other organizations that don't like to have their political, legislative endorsement decisions hobbled takes some time, and it takes confidence and trust building and having good people from those organizations, preferably rank and file members, but staff people too, that's who they want to send, on the steering committee, and learning that they're not going to call the shots, you know, which is a problem historically, some people know here, but parts of the Working Families Party, you know. And some unions have left, some unions have stuck with it, hopefully some unions are getting better at letting the rank and file make more decisions as opposed to a few people putting the most money in the treasury. But you guys are the experts on that. And the sister here, and then the brother in green.
Oh, so my question follows Alice's. I came back from Washington to say, okay, what's the next step? And if I'm hearing you right, you're saying for people like me, who are not hooked in or plugged into any particular organization, we just have to sit and wait till somebody bubbles to the top? What
no,
do we do
no,
now?
No. Nothing's going to bubble to, nothing much, not enough, is going to bubble to the top if we sit and wait.
I don't think anything's bubbling.
Maybe that works for brewing tea, but I maybe I wasn't clear. What I'm saying is we need, you know, what some people call self-activity, local initiative. I mean, if we're waiting for someone else to develop the grand plan for independent political action or fighting Trump or, you know, taking over City Hall, you know, people have to get together and figure out what they can work on together and what are achievable goals, and they got to be patient and persistent. And over time, I think, you know, in many places you can make a dent.
Is politics the only venue to do that?
No. I mean, hey, I as a union rep, was much more oriented, union activist for many years, towards workplace activities, strikes, organizing. I did not like electoral politics other than being a longtime supporter of Bernie out of state. I was based in Massachusetts, the Progressive Party, the Labor Party, when that was around to support. I was willing to give the Working Families Party a chance in Massachusetts, notwithstanding at that time its somewhat checkered record in New York. I'm kind of ecumenical, but electoral politics was never my focus. When you move to a place like Richmond, you see what people have been able to build and accomplish at the local level. How can you not get involved? But people there are definitely not putting their eggs in the basket of, oh, let's elect a nice slate of people and they'll make good things happen. This rent control fight, as I said, they set that as a goal 15 years ago. When the city council 2 years ago passed an ordinance that included the requirement of just cause for evictions and a rent rollback and create a rent control board, the California Apartment Association swooped in with paid canvassers, got 6,000 signatures, and under California law were able to nullify the rent control ordinance. We had to go back, canvass, get 6,000 more signatures to get it on the ballot last fall. During that time, people weren't just collecting signatures and filing petitions and passing ordinances, there were rent strikes. ACE, the successor to ACORN, went after landlords who were raising rent hikes. They got tenants to go into the streets to embarrass these people. There were public hearings where tenants came and spoke about being facing eviction and being driven out of the city. Big educational campaign. People in ACE went around to the faith leaders, you know, some of whom have been in the pocket of Chevron, you know, since it was Standard Oil, and shamed them into taking a more positive stance on this issue of housing affordability and getting their names on the Fair and Affordable Housing Coalition letterhead, you know, storefront ministers, Catholic priests in the big Latino, you know, congregations, and some African American ministers. So, I mean, is that electoral politics or is that grassroots organizing that puts you in a position to win when you have an election or a referendum vote on a key measure that has a concrete economic impact on people's family budget, their ability to stay in a place, and their ability, like a union member, to have due process when their landlord tries to turf them out, right? It's like having a grievance procedure and a fair hearing and legal recourse where none existed before. It's like having a Wagner Act where there wasn't one before, yeah. Right? So, yes.
So, slightly different direction, but you mentioned before the fight about the soda tax.
Yes.
Was a problem for the, I gather, for RPA.
Yes.
Not just losing, but
backfired big time, yeah. You know, it's an interesting part of the story. Since then, of course, Berkeley has passed a soda tax and San Francisco and Oakland and Philadelphia as a revenue enhancer and to develop a revenue stream to pay for parks, recreation, sports, and public health education. The guy who pushed this in 2012 had served for 4 years as an RPA city council member, progressive doc. Andy may know him. Jeff Ritterman, ponytailed 60s radical who rose to be chief of cardiology at Kaiser Richmond Medical Center. In the course of his practice, this guy is dealing with the human wreckage, you know, that obesity, junk food, sugary drinks is creating. And not just among older people of color who now have diabetes and heart disease and, you know, have to have limbs amputated. Richmond has the highest level, one of the highest levels of childhood obesity in the state. This is like a well-documented public health crisis, right? Okay, but sometimes what makes good public policy sense is poison in local politics, because the American Beverage Association swooped in with a big AstroTurf campaign, $2 million in expenditures against our candidates, against the soda tax, penny per ounce, pretty modest, only would have raised about $2 or $3 million for parks and recreation, health education, kids' sports programs. And that's, you know, two or more million on top of Chevron's usual $1 or $2 million, you know. But the worst thing was the race class, you know, divisions. I mean, it was the wedge issue from heaven for the other side. It is a regressive tax on poor and working people, just like a tax on cigarettes to discourage cigarette use is a regressive tax. I think it's a defensible one, but in that context, the beverage industry brought in Willie Brown, former mayor of San Francisco, African-American elder, paid him $10,000, mobilized the NAACP against this, the black ministers, all the Latino grocery store owners had signs about how much this was going to cost. They had little things hanging on the soda bottles in the stores. This is what your Coke will cost if Measure N passes. And the rap was that this was a social engineering nanny state scheme imposed on people of color by the white elitists who control the Richmond Plantation Alliance. You've heard of dog whistle politics? There's a reverse dog whistling that goes on at election time in Richmond. That kind of appeal to tribal solidarity is very powerful. We had a couple of black public health workers on the pro-soda tax side, a courageous black minister, Reverend Alvin Bernstein, is in the book, who said, hey folks, sugar, slavery, you know,
it's only a
literature. Have you read your history? The ABA is not a friend of the black community. And he, in his church, has a soda-free, fry-free zone in a social hall like this. He is the exception, not the rule in Richmond. But, you know, and you, lest you think that this game plan, we will not be seeing it soon, I hope people took a close look at this article in the Times just a week or so ago, the Koch brothers' newest strategy for beating back anything that would curb global warming is the Koch strategy that now mixes gospel and oil policy. And taking a page, which I just described, out of the American Beverage Association AstroTurf campaign handbook, they have now created a front group. It's called Fueling U.S. Forward. They're going to spend millions of dollars on gospel concerts where the message at halftime is anybody that wants to you know, raise taxes on fossil fuel or shift to renewable energy, do anything to curb global warming and carbon emissions, is imposing a regressive tax on poor and working people and people of color. And they've already rustled up some people of color front groups to have conferences about this, and they think that this is a key front of their campaign to push their environmental agenda, if you can call it that. And if you think that this doesn't have potential traction, I read the part of the book about our soda tax campaign. And, you know, the same sort of backlash developed against Bloomberg's scheme about portion size, right? Yeah. The only reason they won in Berkeley, I think 2 years ago, 2 years after we got shocked in Richmond, was because Bloomberg Foundation gave the organizers $600,000, a budget that we didn't have, we had $30,000. And they learned from the Richmond debacle and found a way to, you know, de-racialize the initiative, which is very important. I mean, no, it was sticky. I mean, black women, body image, I mean, the stuff that this thing stirred up. And, you know, it was well-intentioned, but nobody understood the hornet's nest that they were poking with this particular initiative. And the contrast between that and rent control, right, which people, why didn't we have this 5 years ago, I would have still been in my old apartment, right? Instead of this new one. But so that is a lesson learned. And the two RPA candidates got wiped out. It's the only election cycle since 2004 where nobody won. And they were taken down by, you know, a good idea, but whose time had not come. May it never come. people are... It's now the third rail of progressive politics. Anybody else? Good questions. Yes.
Yeah, I think that what people are saying about the, you know, the great raise in activity right now is really very real. We see it in the demonstrations for sure, which were astounding. But it seems to me in Albany here, and I think this is happening all over, people who are in motion, groups that are in motion, are getting an influx of new people, are, you know, getting more people interested, which is all to the good. But one of my concerns is that it's a new period, that one, right? But it's also a new period in terms of the dangers. And it seems to me that it's very crucial that people in different organizations certainly intensify the work they're doing, but we have to build coalitions on different levels, resistance coalitions, not to take people away from good activity they're doing now, but to allow coordination and to allow more effective emergency mobilization. You know, sanctuary city, we may have to defend that here. To pick up even more of immigrant people and so forth. And that's what I'm not seeing so much here, the thrust to find a way to coalesce as well as do more of what we're already doing.
Mm-hmm. Well, you know, I didn't bring a lot of handouts. There is a piece up here that people might be interested in that Gayle McLaughlin put together, sort of the lessons of the last 15 years. There's, you know, reporting on it in the book. I've got a copy of the RPA bylaws, give you an idea of the structure. There's some sample membership literature that we use. We try to sign people up. You know, check it out, but it's not like people in Richmond have solved every organizational problem, and as we discussed earlier, other electoral contexts and states and cities, you know, you'd have to develop a different approach.
You're a coalition as well as a membership organization.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. You have organizational people affiliated as well.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so it's kind of a hybrid. And then the other thing is the year-round organizing, some of which is done by the organizational affiliates, but having a central clearinghouse, having a coordinating body, and then, you know, again, the people that, starting with Gayle, she went in there, took a supposedly half-time job, weak mayor system. We have a city manager who does the actual administrative work, part-time city councilor. She turned that into a bully pulpit for organizing. And in and out, you know, Shama Sawant is another great example of this in Seattle.
Yeah.
She has not stopped organizing from the first time she got elected. And she uses her city council position, in her case, to hold public hearings, to support local groups, to help them build their organization. And of course, at election time, they turn out for her. In Richmond, that insider-outside synergy has been key. Also, seating boards and commissions. In Richmond, we have a planning commission, housing commission, library commission, parks and recreation. I'm now stuck as a union-backed member of the Richmond personnel board. All right, you know, boring, long meetings. We had a six-hour hearing the other day and a five-day suspension involving SEIU employee. But, you know, it's a stop on their grievance procedure if they want to use it. Well, okay, you're a progressive city council majority. Don't forget the personnel board. You want to stack with a bunch of people that don't like public employee unions or, you know, people who are believe in collective bargaining. So you don't have to get elected once you gain a foothold to start having influence throughout many of the bodies that make important decisions to help shape city policy and can monitor what city employees are doing in different parts of the municipal organization. You know, the policing chapter is really worth looking at if you've had problems with police brutality, and almost everybody does. We now have a citizen police review board. It's mandated to investigate any major incident of, force used on a civilian. We only had two officer-involved fatalities in the last 10 years, during a period when civilian homicides have been reduced by, I would say, 250 to 300, mainly young people of color, ended up killing themselves, right? So the problem in Richmond at this point is not the cops, it's young people drawn into drugs and gangs and gun violence. And there's a great innovative program to try to reduce that that's described in the book. But, you know, and it's not like the police reform was uncontested. The police officers union under previous leadership was pretty hostile. We had a police chief who was not only gay, pretty unusual, but also participated in a Black Lives Matter demonstration on McDonald Avenue, the main street in Richmond. You know, the police union tried to claim that he had violated state law for participating in partisan political activity in his uniform. He said, hey, I'm on duty, and I, you know, support peaceful protests in Richmond, and I'm showing my support for Black Lives, White Lives, you know, he did the whole rap. You know, a few miles away, at the same time, there was riots and fights with the cops in Oakland and Berkeley because the news had just come in from Ferguson and New York and Baltimore about all the atrocities in these places. You know, and some of the cops can be won over. The current cop union president came to the kickoff for this book. He was a big source for the chapter. He's a guy from Montana, grew up on a Flathead Indian reservation. His father was a tribal chieftain. He's an Iraq war veteran. When he came to Richmond in 2005, he said he could not believe the level of gun violence. He thought he was back in Baghdad. This guy takes advantage of a perk that other cities should adopt, which is housing. So Ben Theriault has lived in a Richmond public housing project for the last 5 years, one of a handful of cops, following the example of our great chief, Chris Magnus, you know, who moved into the city. His colleagues think he's crazy, but they elected him president of the union. He was critical of the citizens' police review board. He doesn't like the fact that internal affairs has been taken out of the police department, and we now have a civilian doing an investigation of police misconduct as part of a professional standards office in City Hall. He's a former cop, a lawyer, former judge, but the police are not investigating themselves in Richmond anymore. So, but these things take time. I mean, if the progressive leadership, Gayle, her administration, city councilors had not given Chris Magnus 10 years to transform this department, it would be like it was, you know, in the old days when the cops ran roughshod over the community. There wasn't 60% of the cops, you know, black, Latino, Asian. There weren't women, many of them in the force. This stuff takes time, particularly in a department with a culture often as hostile to reform, not to mention progressive transformation, as any city police department. So I'll stop there. Okay. I want to thank people for coming. Hope you like the book. And, thank you again.